Thank you, sir, for your enlightening address. May I now have the privilege of inviting our chief guest, Honorable Union Minister for Finance, Corporate Affairs, Information and Broadcasting, Shri Arun Jaitley, for his insights and words of guidance to financial sector.
Justice B.S. Sri Krishna, Mr. Siridharan, Mr. Ashish Chauhan, Mr. Sinha, eminent leaders of the financial and the corporate sector, ladies and gentlemen. I'm extremely grateful to the Institute of Company Secretaries for having invited me to speak in this interaction which they've organized on the Indian Financial Code and the FSRC's recommendations which are pending consideration and implementation by the government. We've just heard a very erudite talk by Justice Sri Krishna. As the talk itself indicated, both his experience and wisdom in the sector. I was just reminding him that he evolved from a lawyer who specialized in the law of industrial relations when he practiced, into a judge who almost dealt with every subject, and then produce one of the finest documents on the financial sector legislative reforms that are required in this country. In fact, the essence of the whole issue goes back to a basic question. Who do we trust more? The government or the markets? We started as an economy which trusted the state much more than we trusted the markets. The initial years of our nation building were all based on a hypothesis that what is big necessary must be evil. And therefore, whether we legislated the Monopolies and Restrictive Trade Practices Act at the initial stages, or we had various other regulatory mechanisms, the government had a predominant role. For the management of the national economy, the government was really the Maibaap. Its business was to do business. Its authority was not to permit people to do business. And therefore, the tighter you could be in terms of management of the economy, you'd be seen to be more progressive. Now, if you look back to a large number of legislations of the late 60s, the early 70s, and if you go back and probably if it's still available on the net, look at some of the mid-70s legislations which emanated from the 20-point program. A very large part of our reform program is based on how we undo that. How how do we restrict the use of capital, because capital itself is not for the benefit of the state. Now, some people really believe that distribution of poverty was more progressive than generation of wealth. And that is how that regulated system operated. So for almost 3.5-4 decades, we lived in a system that was regulated. And slowly we realized that it's important, and we realized the bitter way. We realized when we were almost on the verge of collapse. And therefore, when we realized that a state-regulated economy is restricting the capacities of India, we need an ability which will unleash our own abilities and capacities. We were on the verge of bankruptcy. That a situation was forced on us when we decided to reform or perish. And of course, when we did decide to reform, there was a huge amount of resistance because there was inability of the large number of people who are otherwise involved in the decision making to understand the benefits of what we were doing. The judge rightly mentioned that change disturbs the status quo and therefore ruffles many feathers. And those who had developed an interest in a state-regulated system did resist that. Our former Prime Minister, Dr. Singh, who was then the Finance Minister, has mentioned that at one stage, while implementing certain set of reforms, he found that he was almost isolated. Till a few stray people got up to back him. And thereafter, when we were reforming sector by sector, we saw various challenges coming up. And in simple language, the challenges were, we had stopped trusting the economy where the state was the only decision maker. But do we then completely trust the markets? And we found in sector after sector, important challenges which started confronting us. I recollect at that stage, when we got an opportunity for the first time to be in government, how the entire political and economic decision making surfaced. You mentioned just now as to how the parliamentary process adjusts to this. I remember when the telecom regulator was first created and it decided to take a decision with regard to tariffs, the minister got up in parliament and said, "Who is this authority who has decided without my knowledge? Am I accountable or this retired civil servant is accountable? The entire accountability is of the government. I answer the parliament, I answer the people. And this non-accountable gentleman has taken a decision which affects the life of the country." There was a walkout in parliament and almost across the board, a large number of MPs felt, how can some retired civil servant be given a job who just decides to affect tariffs which affect every consumer in the world or in India? Judicial review, we are all proud of. But judicial review itself Because when you reform, other institutions have to also accept the changed environment. Every decision of the regulator was challenged under Article 226 and would have to wait for decades or till the cows came home before it could be implemented. High courts, by and large, frustrated the decisions of the regulator. Because they said the ultimate power of judicial review is ours, and a petition has come up, therefore, why should we allow this to be implemented? And therefore, the reform in the sector had to wait. And in the telecom sector, when we started with a 0.8% teledensity, that is less than 1% of people in India had a telephone connection, for the first 4 or 5 years, we remained thereabout. And this was a great learning experience for us in the political system and the government, where investors came to us and said, how can government be a key decision maker? You have your own BSNL and MTNL to run. You are a competitor. And you decide the rules of the game. So the rules obviously cannot be decided by a competitor. And therefore, when state monopolies were cracking up and these areas were being opened to a private sector, the state can't be a player and a decision maker. You can't be a player and a referee at the same time. And that's when government started realizing the merit of having a regulator, whether it was insurance or it was telecom or it was any other field. The judge would pardon me if I said so, that this problem was not only with parliament, this problem was also with courts. So when the Competition Commission of India was first constituted, the aberrations in the market, who will check? So that's when you go back to the basic question. You can't trust the government, and therefore you trust the market that it will find its own level. But what if there are aberrations in the market? Do you need a regulator to set the rules of the game? So when the Competition Commission of India was first set up, it couldn't function for 4 years because the then Chief Justice of India thought that how are these jobs meant for retired judges being given to somebody else? And the comment precisely was, these are quasi-judicial posts. If you had your way, you will get the executive to fill them up. And with this comment, the functioning of the Competition Commission remained stayed. So both Parliament and the Supreme Court were finding it equally difficult to adjust that India needs somebody who has the requisite capacity to act as a regulator and an expertise in that field. And now we have reached a stage where, fortunately, 24 or 23 years after we started liberalizing, we are trying to find that balance that we've broken away from the governmental monopolies. On an interesting sidelight, we frown on private monopolies, but we are still having a provision in the Constitution, Judge, which says governmental monopolies will never be struck down. So to your freedom of trade and business, the restriction under Article 19(6) says that however, monopolies will be bad, but as long as they are not government monopolies. So government monopolies are permitted. So right from 1950, we are continuing with that provision. So we've broken away from this era of governmental monopolies in the commercial field. The government ceased to be the rule maker and the referee. It's a player at best in some fields. It has some role in policy in those fields. It gives a direction. And then you have the mechanism of a professional regulator where a lot of capacity building has been taking place. And to find that level between high courts not indefinitely staying regulators, courts not feeling that a judicial power or a quasi-judicial power has been vested in a non-judicial authority, an interim forum, an appellate authority, which is normally necessarily a judge-headed appellate authority, has been created. So you have experts in the field who decide. The appeal lies to the appellate authority. And from there, of course, you have your remedy to go to the Supreme Court or whichever court which is provided. It is at this junction that we stand today. We've covered a reasonable amount of distance, starting from 91 and effectively from the late 90s when the regulators started working, and it is here that we are now. And it is at this stage that we now need to institutionalize this mechanism and really need to learn from not only the best practices in India, but the best global practices. And the Commission's report is an extremely important step in that direction. The framework is holistic. And if we take into account the fragilities of some of the systems and how they can be exploited. And therefore, under the present circumstances, there are a lot of changes which may be required after studying the report at length. There are four different groups which have been set up, which are examining every aspect. Some legislative changes will also be required. And I think with a combination of these administrative and legislative changes, the regulatory mechanism, a professionally regulatory mechanism, will come here to stay. This journey is a very interesting one. We move from a state-regulated mechanism to a mechanism where we thought the markets would decide. But then somebody else had to step in to keep a keen eye on the market, to do the rulemaking required for each sector, to settle disputes with regard to those sectors, to watch consumer interest, to prevent any form of aberration which takes place. And that is really the role of a sectoral regulator, which in turn now can go ahead and have its orders appealed to the financial sector regulator. And once we have this ideal mechanism in place, an original mechanism is there, the Commission's report, which is, I think, an excellent document in this regard, is certainly going to be of great avail. And I'm sure, as soon as the entire process of change and reform continues, you are right, Judge, when you say that there is no substitute to learning from experience that we have and changing whatever, wherever we have to change in a larger national interest. I have not the least doubt that a large number of these recommendations would actually see implementation as a daylight reality in the days to come. I'm extremely grateful to the Honorable Judge and his entire team for having produced an excellent document. And I'm extremely grateful to the Company Secretaries Institute for having taken the initiative in giving a push to these suggestions so that you can have the informed fraternity discuss these at length at your day-long symposiums, which are here. Thank you very much.